Wow, what a morning, right? So thank you to Joe and the choir and our youth and Megan. Very special, thanks. Now for a scripture reading from the Old Testament, from the book of Micah, chapter 5, verses 2 through 5a, and it's on page 922. But you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come for me one who will be the ruler over Israel, whose origins are from old, from ancient times. Therefore, Israel will be abandoned until the time when she who is in labor gives birth, and the rest of his brothers return to join the Israelites. He will stand and shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God, and they will live securely, for then his greatness will reach to the ends of the earth, and he will be their peace. And from the New Testament, book of Luke, chapter 1, verses 39 through 55. This is on page 1013. At that time, Mary got ready and hurried to a town in the hill country of Judea, where she entered Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. In a loud voice, she exclaimed, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear. But why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me? As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. Blessed is she who has believed that what the Lord has said to her will be accomplished." And Mary said, "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed many deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but he has sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, even as he said to our fathers."
Good morning. It is so nice to see all of you today, and our children, our youth, and adults worshiping together in this room. This is the last Sunday of Advent, and Christmas is just around the corner. And we will celebrate the birth of Jesus together, and tomorrow night, and we'll have a candlelight Christmas Eve service, and lighting candles, and singing the hymn, Silent Night and Holy Night, tomorrow. It is going to be a meaningful Christmas Eve service, but in case that there are people here who may not be able to make it tomorrow, we greet one another. Merry Christmas. Jesus Christ is born. Let's all rise and greet one another in the name of Jesus. So first of all, I'd like to deliver my message to the kids, since we don't have any children's message today separately. So I'm going to give the message to the children first. Hi, children. So I brought the long string here, and I have a question for you. Do you think your parents or grandparents love you?
Absolutely.
Oh, okay. How much do you think they love you? How much? Like this much? Or bigger? Like this? Oh, this is big. Oops. Bigger than that? Oh, a little bigger? Like how bigger? A lot bigger? Like whole wall? Oh, wow. Okay, grandparents. Jim, do you think they love you more or you love them more?
Oh, that's a trick question.
Okay. So if you make a big circle with this, how big it might be?
Too big to see it.
Too big to see it. Yeah. You know, how about God's love? How big is God's love for us?
Even bigger.
We want to see it. See how big the love of God is. So Teddy will come up and help me, right? So make a big circle with this. I'm going to hold the other end. And make a big circle to include everybody here. Oh. Okay, so let's see how big circle we can make. Use the finger. All right, yeah. That's mom. She is everywhere when he needs help. Yeah. Wow. So make sure to include everybody. Is God's love big enough to include everyone? Does God love us when we make a mistake even? Does God love us when we don't behave properly? Oh. Does God sometimes not feel like God loves us? No. So does God love us no matter what happened to us? God's love is big enough to love everyone in this room. And God's love is big enough to love everyone in the world. So, yeah, that's kind of big enough. And what about the choir, Teddy? God doesn't love them? So, kids, I want you to come up here and see how big the circle is. Hey, kids, come on. Here. This is the best place to see everyone, right? So how big is the circle?
Really big.
Very big, right? Okay, you can come back. Come back to your seat. All right, thank you. So every time you doubt about God's love, okay? Every time you are curious if God really loves me, remember this circle. God includes everyone. God loves everyone, no matter what. No matter who they are, no matter what they have done. God loves them, everyone. Every one of us. No one is excluded. Everyone is accepted by God, no matter who they are and what they have done. Amen?
Amen.
All right. Let's pray down then. Okay, then I'm going to talk to the adults. A wife asks her husband. You know, I always start with joke, right? So this is a joke. Make sure that I want you to know that. Because this is a kind of bad joke. A wife asked her husband, "How would you describe me?" And he replied, "A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, H, I, J, K." The confused wife asked, "What does that mean?" And her husband replied, "Adorable, beautiful, cute, delightful, elegant, fashionable, gorgeous, and HH hot." The wife said, "Wow, thank you, honey. And what about IJK? The husband takes a pause and said, "I'm just kidding." Oh, again, this is a joke, all right? So your kids, your dad really think your mom is A, B, C, D, F, G, H, and there's no I, J, K, okay? Let me ask you a serious question this time. Do you have someone you love so much? Have you ever loved a person or persons so much? Then you may agree with me that love expresses itself. It cannot be held inside of us without being expressed. When we really love someone, we want to give our best to the person. This is very important in love, that we want to let the person know how much we love him or love her. In order to let the person know our love, we often plan to make a big surprise that may maximize the effect. Until his high school years, my son, who is sitting in the back, had to play the role to hide my gift until the surprise moment in the restaurant. My son hid my gift and my card inside his shirt, and with my cue, he gave it to my wife. And then I realized later that my wife has the same plan. So my son had both gifts and cards from me and from my wife without letting either of us know about it. After he had done the same thing over and over, he did not want to play the role anymore. Does God do the same, do you think? Does God want us to know how much God loves us? Does God even make a surprise plan to make sure that we understand the love of God? Yes, God does. God does so all the time. God surprises us with his plan. Luke chapter 1, today's passage, is full of God's surprise plan, God's surprise plans in relation to the birth of Jesus. This is the first rule of how God does God's work in the world. God may arrange things, but God loves to work through the people and with the people. Not just any people, but the people who accept God's will, pleasantly in most cases, or even reluctantly in some cases. Sometimes the people God uses don't know they are doing God's work, but most of the time God exposes God's plan to the people and invite them to work with God. The problem of God in Luke chapter 1 was, though, that God had to make Mary to agree to give a birth to a baby, Jesus, who was not conceived by her fiancé or on her own will. In other words, among many things, it should be one of the hardest plans for God because it was not something anyone would do without fully agreeing with God. All moms here may understand what I'm talking about. God's goal was not just to make Mary accept God's plan, but also to make her excited about it so that the Son of God could be born through Mary. So God planned a series of surprise plans. First of all, an angel of God appeared to Zechariah in chapter 1. He's a priest, and he told him, and the angel told him that his wife would have a baby. This was God's plan number one. Then God made him a mute, so he could not tell anyone about God's plan, including his wife. He could not even explain it to his wife, Elizabeth. Then Elizabeth became pregnant. This was the plan B, plan number two. But she couldn't understand how her barrenness suddenly disappeared. It was possible for her to explain to others. It was impossible for her to explain to others when she herself didn't have any clue. So she hid herself from others for 5 months. Luke chapter 1, verse 25 shows that she believed it as the work of God, but she could not hear any affirmation from anybody. After a month, the same angel who appeared to Zechariah came to Mary this time. He told her that she would have a baby by the Holy Spirit, who was to be called the Son of God. And this was the plan number 3. Mary had a mixed feeling about God's plan. She accepted God's will, but at the same time, she was afraid of having a baby before she married. You see, her pregnancy would be an immediate reality, and the promise of God would be too far away. How could she embrace her pregnancy in belief in the promise that seems too far away and obscure? This was why the angel executed number 4 plan. He gave one proof to Mary to convince her. Mary, you know Elizabeth, your relative, right? Who could not have a baby. But see, she has a baby now. She is 6 months pregnant. No word from God will ever fail. Then Mary fully accepted God's plan to give a birth to the baby, but she wanted to see the proof. So she rushed off to Elizabeth. According to the traditional interpretation, Mary had to walk 80 miles to visit Elizabeth to see the proof, which could take more than a week. Can you imagine that? What that journey just must have been like to Mary. Mary was desperate to seek the proof of God's promise through Elizabeth. At the same time, Elizabeth was desperate to hear from someone how her pregnancy became possible. So today's passage, chapter 1, 39 through 55, describes the moment that two women met together. The angel of God executed 4 different plans for this very moment to make both of them convinced that God worked through them and that their babies would be used by God to save the entire humanity. And this moment transformed both of them, turning their concerns and fear into overwhelming joy and gratitude. And verse 41 says, when Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. She knew she was favored by God, that the mother of the Lord came to her. Maybe this was the plan number 5, even though it's not described in the Bible. To make the baby leap in the womb. Then Mary was also filled with joy hearing what Elizabeth confessed. And she said, my soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior, because he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. And she confessed that God gave his favor to her, not because she deserved it, but because she realized that God lifted up her humble state. Yes, God always likes to lift up the humble and to break down those who pride themselves. God always works through the people who are weak and meek. God always works through those who are humbled or even humiliated, because God knows that it is the time they really rely on nothing but God only. God knows it is the time God reveals God's restorative power.
Folks, in the time when we are embarrassed by our failures, in the time when we are abandoned by our close friends or families, in the time when people treat us like nobody or invisible, it is ironically the time God shows God's love and affirmation to us through a whispering voice. Do you now realize who truly loves you? Do you now realize who keeps you to the end? God's unconditional love endures forever, no matter what happens to our life. This is a message God wants to give to us through the story of Mary and Elizabeth. And as I explained, God set up four plans to let Mary know God's saving grace for humanity. First, through Zechariah, through Elizabeth, and angel said to Mary directly, and finally, by arranging their meeting between two women. God wanted her to know that she was not just a tool for God's plan to be carried out, but God's partner working together with God. The grace of God was given to her so that she could embrace it first before she made the whole world joyful. In fact, God even planned the moment, even long time ago, according to the prophet Micah in chapter 5, verse 2 and 3. But you, O Bethlehem, O Ephrathah, you are one of the little clans of Judah. From you shall come forth for me one who rules in Israel, whose origin is from old, from ancient days. Therefore he shall give them up until the time when she who is in labor has brought forth. Then the rest of his kindred shall return to the people of Israel. So God had planned even long before, besides four plans in today's chapter. Many Christians deem the birth of baby Jesus is not so important in Christian faith. The death and resurrection of Jesus are all we need to know in relation to the grace of God. But this is total misunderstanding. Why? Because such an idea negates the insanely tedious process of God's saving plan, beginning from establishing the people of God of Israel, leading them from the slavery in Egypt, giving them the law of God, sending so many prophets to them, and then finally sending the Son of God to the world. God planned from a long time ago, and even at the very moment, God had four plans to persuade Elizabeth and Mary. This is how God works in the world. God wants us to know how much God loves us. God has plans. God set up these different plans for us. This is what love looks like, always. Love is patient. Love is vulnerable. Love is full of embarrassing stories that people would tell at the family parties. Hey, I know what you did when you were dating. Love is full of such stories. Love is messy. Kids, did you know your parents watch your poop every time? Ew. But that was true. They check your poop every time to see your health conditions. Love is messy. But this messiness is love. Finally, love entails a lot of plans to let the person know how about your love. To be attentive to the needs of the person is a basic expression of love of God. Brothers and sisters in Christ, the story of Elizabeth and Mary and the story of baby Jesus born in a manger in the inn are not introduced in the Bible to make us happy and get us in the mood for the holidays. As we have seen from Luke chapter 1, those stories show us how God works diligently to make all things work together for good. Those stories help us understand the meaning of Emmanuel, God is with us, and how God plans diligently to make us know God's love for us. This is why Christmas is all about hope, peace, joy, and love. Just like God did to Elizabeth and Mary in Luke chapter 1, God assures us of God's ceaseless love for us, planning for us, and trying to surprise us. God is committed to loving us, no matter what happens to us. So if you are going through a time of humiliation and shame, difficulties, a time of failure, a time of disappointments, it is not the end of our relationship with God, but the beginning of true relationship with Him. There has not been any change in love from God's side. God hasn't changed. Maybe this is the time we hear God's whispering voice that says, "Stop taking yourself so seriously. You are not in control from here. I am. Just relax and see what I do for you." Folks, Mary exclaimed in Luke 1:46, "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant." And in this Christmas time, the best way to celebrate the birth of Jesus is to accept the joy and gratitude God gives to our humble hearts, just like Mary exclaimed with overwhelming joy. And we also praise the love of God poured upon us. And I would like to sing the song with you all today. This is the love of God to us. The love of God is greater far than tongue or pen can ever tell. It goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. The guilty pair bow down with care. God gave his son to win. His erring child he reconciled and pardoned from his sin. O love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong. It shall forevermore endure the saints and angels' song. When years of time shall pass away and earthly thrones and kingdoms fall, when men who were refuse to pray on rocks and hills and mountains call, God's love so sure shall still endure, O measureless and strong. Redeeming grace to Adam's race, the saints and angels. O love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong, he shall forevermore endure the saints and angels' song. Could we with the ocean fill and were the skies of parchment made, were every stalk on earth a quill and every man a scribe by trade, to write the love of God above, who drained the ocean dry, nor could a scroll contain the whole, so does it from screens to sky. O love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong, it shall forevermore endure the saints and angels' song.
Amen. So say hello to the people next to you. Merry Christmas to you all. Let's pray. Sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm have worked salvation for him. The Lord has made his salvation known and revealed his righteousness to the nations. He has remembered his love and his faithfulness to the house of Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our Lord. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Burst into jubilant song with music. Make music to the Lord with a harp. With a harp and the sound of singing, with trumpets, and the blast of the ram's horn. Shout for joy before the Lord, the King. Now Christians will light the candles.
including the Christ candle.
We have watched and we have waited in hope. For peace. For joy. And for love. Now our redemption draws near. Hear the word of the Lord from Isaiah 9, verses 2 through 7. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who have lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation, you have increased its joy. They rejoice before you, as with you at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the trampling warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a son has been born for us, a son is given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. Glory to God in the highest. Alleluia. Amen.
Now let's open our bulletin and then pray together. All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God. Hallelujah.
Shout to the Lord, all the earth. Hallelujah.
O Christ, splendor of God's eternal glory, the mighty word, sustaining the universe, renew our lives by your presence.
Lord, have mercy.
O Christ, begotten of the Father before all time, born in a stable in Bethlehem, may your church be a sign of hope and joy.
Lord, have mercy.
O Christ, truly God and truly human, born to a people in fulfillment of their expectations, fulfill our desires in you.
Lord, have mercy.
O Christ, born of the Virgin Mary, child of wonder and splendor, mighty God of all ages, Prince of Peace, may the world live in peace and justice.
Lord, have mercy.
All-powerful and unseen God, the coming of your light into our world has brightened weary hearts with peace. Teach us to proclaim the birth of your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
The old carol, there's a song in the air, speaks to me of joy. For some of us, joy doesn't come naturally at this time of year. Exhaustion catches up with me as I try to tune 3 or 4 pianos a day, plus trying to keep up with all of the other daily chores. I go into a friend's beautifully decorated, tidy home, smelling of freshly baked cookies, and I wonder if I will ever get enough done. And then this lovely old carol calls to me that the beautiful saying about the king caring enough to come into the world in the form of a baby to be with us.
Thank you, Tammy. If you have Bible at handy and close to you, you can read the Bible together with me. I'm going to read Isaiah part, and then we're going to read Luke alternatively. So I'm going to read Isaiah first. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 2 through 7. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at harvest, as men rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdened them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, will be fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful, Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. Now let's read Luke chapter 2. We're going to read verse 1 through 20. So we're going to read it alternatively. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world.
This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria.
And everyone went to his own town to register.
So Joseph went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house of the line of David.
He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born. And she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in clothes and placed him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were shepherds living in the field nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified.
But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people.
Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. You will find a baby wrapped in clothes and manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying,
"Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom favor rests."
When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about."
So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger.
When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what has happened, what has been told them about this child. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherd returned, glorifying and praising God for all things he had seen, which were just as they said. Thank you. So today is Christmas Eve. The worship committee of Mendon Church decided to have this service in a later time rather than an early time, hoping that it may help us contemplate on the meanings of Christmas Eve and Christmas time as well. We lit the candles of hope, peace, joy, and love, and we lit the Christ candle at the last because Jesus is the one who has brought hope, peace, joy, and love to us. We cannot anticipate hope without Christ. Peace is unthinkable without Christ. Joy and love are unimaginable without Christ, because all of these qualities are only coming from God, not from the world. Not many people are good at explaining these qualities. For example, some people narrow down love to all kinds of hormone theories and brain activity. Some other people consider love as a social construction, insisting that the definition of love has evolved over time, and there is no everlasting love in the world. What do you think of these approaches?
I guess none of these approaches successfully give us an idea what true love is. What do I mean by true love? As you may know already, there are three kinds of love. First of all, there's a kind of love like we say, we love you because such, such. Because you treat me well. Because you give me an awesome gift. Because you are funny. So I love you. I love you. There's another kind of love that says, if. I will love you if you do such, such. I love you if you do what I ask for. I love you if you make me happy. But these kind of love are very conditional. And we cannot expect love anymore if the conditions of love go away. A French writer, Albert Camus, said, "The desire for possession is insatiable to such a point that it can survive even love itself. To love, therefore, is to sterilize the person one loves." So the conditional love, like because or if, easily turns to obsession or manipulation at the cost of love itself, which creates destructive relationship. At the cost of love itself, we call it love. Luke chapter 2, verse 1 through 20, today's passage, tell us about how God orchestrated all things to show God's love through baby Jesus. As you may know, Luke is the only gospel in the New Testament we can hear about the actual scene around the night that Jesus was born. Matthew, Gospel of Matthew, focuses on Joseph, his agony, and his decisions, but not much on Mary or the moment of the birth of Jesus. Mark and John do not mention about the birth of Jesus at all. The Gospel of Mark begins with the introduction of John the Baptist, and the Gospel of John provides a theological description that Jesus was the Word of God, who became a human. But it doesn't say anything about the birth of Jesus. So the words like manger, shepherds, no room in the inn, all these kind of expressions we can hear only from the Gospel of Luke. The story of the birth of Jesus in Luke chapter 2 begins with Joseph and Mary going to Bethlehem from Galilee. The purpose of their trip was to register the household of Joseph in his ancestral hometown, Bethlehem. The registration was ordered by the Roman Emperor Caesar Augustus to make it easy to collect taxes from all the conquered people. Since Israel was located at the very end of imperial territory, Joseph and his fiancée, Mary, also had to make their 90-mile trek toward Bethlehem from Galilee, even though she got close to her due date. I read some interesting definition about human power. Somebody said, power means to be able to make others do meaningless works. For example, the great pyramids were known as tombs for the kings in Egypt. And tens of thousands of workers were mobilized to build them for decades. But nobody could complain about the work because they were afraid of the pharaohs. Likewise, the Great Wall of China that ran over 13,000 miles Can you imagine that? 13,000 miles of wall was built by innumerable people for such a long period of time, only to be found that its dynasty collapsed not because of an enemy from outside, but because of a betrayer from inside. Power does not explain the people, the meaning of their works. Power does not try to motivate people to join the work. Power means an imposition of taxes or labors on the people without their representation. The trip of Joseph and Mary to Bethlehem exhibited the life of the oppressed people of the time who had to submit themselves to the totalitarian rule of the empire. None of these projects had to do with the well-being of the people. Their works were nothing to do with their own benefit, but for the benefit of the oppressor's interest. Think about their journey. Think about Joseph and parturient Mary on the 90-mile journey for days and days. There is nothing exciting about their journey. There was nothing they could be benefited from the journey, but they had to take all the risks of giving a birth, a baby, to a baby on the road. Without this understanding, we hardly find the meaning of the birth of Jesus. We all confess that Jesus came to save all of us from our sins. We all acknowledge that all humans are sinful, so fall short of the glory of God. But what is a human sin? How do you define human sin? Many people insinuate that human sins are what we can see from the news. Crimes and violations of rules and regulations are identified as human sins. So decent and ordinary people are exempted from the category of sinners. Then how can we say that Jesus came to save all of us from our sins? In Romans 1:5, Paul defines human sins like this. They exchanged the truth of God for a lie and worshiped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. The Roman Empire exactly fit into this category because it promised Pax Romana. That's the logo, motto of the empire, Pax Romana, which means peace of Rome. The economy was booming and jobs were created and secured. And the emperor was called the Son of God and the Lord of the world. The people that lived under its power could not imagine that the empire would be destroyed one day. They managed their life within the system, believing in the promise of the empire Pax Romana and trying to climb up the ladder of success within the empire. This entire system was established as a visible manifestation of human sins. That clearly represented human sins. The Gospel of Luke makes it clear by mentioning all the major names of the officials and religious leaders surrounding Judea area: Caesar Augustus, Quirinius, Tiberius Caesar, Pontius Pilate, Herod, Philip, Lysanias, Annas, and Caiaphas. All of these names are introduced in the birth story of Jesus and his first ministry. Jesus was born into this situation. The Gospel of Luke tries to compare the new kingdom Jesus would bring to the world, with the world ruled by these names. So we have to understand that the birth and ministry of Jesus characteristically explains what God's salvation through Jesus looks like. We can understand his birth and ministry better if we compare him with his contemporary rulers. Following the order of the emperor, Joseph and Mary arrived in Bethlehem. But they could not find any room because everybody was traveling for the same reason, which was to be registered as taxpayers. Since Bethlehem was a small town, many scholars have suggested that the existence of any commercial inn might be unlikely. We can guess that Joseph and Mary stayed in a stable of someone's house because it was his last remained space in his house. So most probably, Mary already felt birth pangs, and even her water already broke. There was no choice but accepting their hospitality. In the midst of this gloomy picture, the reason why I had to go to Bethlehem, the reason why I couldn't find any inn, any space to give birth to Jesus, in spite of all this gloomy picture in describing the birth of Jesus, everything is turned around suddenly with an introduction of the shepherds. The shepherd who lived in the fields. They were watching over the flocks at night. The angel of God appeared to them, and the glorious light shone around them. The angel said, "Do not be afraid. I'll bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ Jesus, Christ the Lord." Then the angel explained how they could recognize the baby Jesus. And as the angel finished his words, a great company of the heavenly host appeared and shouted, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests." It is very amazing to find how the shepherds were given such an important role, because they were among the most ignored people. We often romanticize those shepherds keeping watch over their flocks by night. But in the first century, shepherds were not considered desirable company. They were doing dirty works for the flocks of the owners. They were poor, they were illiterate, and they were frequently mentioned as liars and thieves because they grazed their flocks on other people's property. Their testimony would not be accepted in a courtroom because they were deemed untrustworthy. They were outcasts of the society, usually ranked together with sailors, butchers, and other despised occupations. However, did you know that these shepherds were the only guests invited by an angel in the Bible? Of course, we know about the story of Magi who visited Jesus, but they were not invited. They actually followed the star by themselves. So these shepherds are the only ones who were invited by an angel. No emperor, no tetrarch, no temple leaders, none of those names who were part of the system called Pax Romana or Peace of Rome was invited. The invitation of the shepherds by the angel is more significant when we consider that they were tending the animals which were raised to be sacrificed in the Jerusalem temple, since their fields were so close to Jerusalem. So in other words, all of these combinations were considered. As the Gospel of Luke delivered us the story of baby Jesus, the ones who worked to sustain the system, temple system, were the ones most ignored by the system, but were invited by God. In this Christmas Eve, we have to think about who controls our lives. Whose rules do we follow? Whose kingdom we feel comfortable and we hope to accomplish? If it is not the kingdom of God, if we just feel comfortable in this kingdom of the world, and we have no desire to see its ending. The Bible calls it sin. When we lose our target, when we fail to recognize our goal toward the kingdom of God, the Bible calls it sin. Jesus Christ came to the world to forgive human sins. And comparing Pax Romana, the peace of Rome, Jesus Christ brings to the world real peace called Pax Christos, the peace of Christ. The peace he brings will come not from military might, but from justice and mercy. He will rule not with coercive force, but with the power of self-sacrificing love. Ironically, the town of Bethlehem was the hometown of King David, the most honored king in the history of Israel. In the same place, in the same small town, the Savior was born, not just for the restoration of the glory of God's people, but also for the restoration of the entire humanity from the power of sin. I believe the easiest signifier of the worldly kingdom is the ones who are in the margin. The people who are ignored and despised by the people of the dominant culture prove us that the worldly power is alive and well. When we see the people who cannot pull themselves out of miserable circumstances, we know there is a high wall around them. The whole system is designed to push more people to the margin. And recently, I was frustrated to know that it was so hard for someone who made a mistake at a young age to have a normal life for the rest of his or her life. We live in a world which is still dominated by little Caesars, a world still enamored with wealth, power, and military might, a world where the lowly still get trampled for too often. Yet, Luke assures us that the ruler of every tyrant eventually comes to an end. As I close my sermon, I want you to remember the 90-mile trip of Joseph and Mary. I want you to remember baby Jesus born in a manger. I want you to remember that the most ignored shepherds were the only ones who were invited by God to see Jesus. Maybe the rulers of the world ridicule and mock all of them, but the great company of the heavenly host surround them and praise God, shouting, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace to man on whom his favor rests." And this Jesus greeted by the despised shepherds, later became the good and true shepherd for sinners. And we believe in this Jesus. We believe in this Jesus with the shepherds. Brothers and sisters in Christ, the Gospel of Luke tries to convince us that the one who was born in a manger will overturn the worldly order that promises false peace. The story of baby Jesus invites us to fix our eyes on Jesus. The story of baby Jesus urges us to treat and love the despised people equally and respectfully. Because Jesus Christ gives his salvation to everyone without exception, making sure no one is excluded. The love of God is so big and so wonderful that it gives everyone the freedom of heaven. Famous Mark Twain said, "The two most important days in our life is the day we were born, and the day we find out why." As people of God, I hope and pray that we may figure out the reason why God gives us life of Jesus in this world. It is because we proclaim the unconditional love of God to all people, especially to the people who are ignored and who are marginalized. Amen.
Gentle Mary, little child, lowly in a manger, there he lay the undefiled, to the world a stranger. Such a baby in such a place, can we be the Savior, as the Savior?
Now we're going to sing a new song. I hope you have the note, music note somewhere. Do you have music note of this song? Oh, I made. Do you have somewhere?
Oh, wait. Next to the copy machine?
Oh, yeah, maybe. I feel like I put it on the table, but maybe not.
There wasn't any at the table?
No. Ooh.
Okay.
Okay. So we're going to listen to the song for the first verse, and then we're going to sing together.
Okay.
Thank you. I made 25 copies, and I'm sure we are more than 25. So please share. If you are a couple, please share. And this song was composed by a black man who used to be a slave. And whenever I hear the spiritual song, I'm astonished to find that how in the midst of such a terrible, labor and then, hardship of their life, they praise God in a way that, they already experienced the heaven, even in the midst of their hardship. So this is one of those songs composed by a black man in 1899. The point is this, Jesus wants to save all of us, all people, without exception. So we have to look at them, look at the people who are in the margin, who are despised, who made a mistake in their life and have a hard time to get back to their normal life. All of those people we have in mind, and we, as a church, we need to approach to them and then let them know that God still loves them and God died, and Jesus Christ died for their sins as well. So let's sing this song together. It's like a very spiritual song. Lift every voice and sing, till earth and heaven ring, ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening skies. Let it resound loud as the rolling sea. Song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. Sing, son of our new day begun. Let us march on till victory is won. Stony the bitter the chastening rod, felt in the days when hope unborn had died. Yet with a steady beat and of our weary feet, come to the place for which our Father sighed. We have come over a way that the tears has been watered. We have come treading our path through the blood of the slaughtered. Out from the gloomy past till now we stand at last, where the white gleam of our brother star is cast. God of our silent tears, though thou hast brought us thus far along the way, thou art the life, thy might. Let us into the light, keep us forever in the path, we pray. Lest our feet stray from the places, our God, where we met thee. Lest our hearts, drunk with the wine of the world, we forget thee. Shadow be blinded, and may we forever stand true to our God, true to our native land. Thank you. We try hard, right? That's good enough. Let's pray together. In the bulletin, you can find our prayer together. Great God of power, we praise you for Jesus Christ, who came to save us from our sins. We thank you for the hope of the prophets, the song of angels, and the birth of Jesus in Bethlehem. We thank you for that in Jesus you became flesh and dwelt among us, sharing human hearts and pleasures. Glory to you for your grace-filled love. Glory to you, eternal God. Through Jesus Christ, Lord of lords and King of kings, now and forever. Amen. So Christmas is the birthday of Jesus Christ. And we know what happened at the end of his life. In the night, when Jesus was arrested, he called his disciples, and they spent 3 years together. So every day they were supposed to have three meals a day. So for 3 years, it was over 1,000 meals together, right? But that night was special because Jesus did something very strange to the eyes of the disciples. He took the bread as usual, but this time he said a very strange thing to his disciples, saying, "See this bread? It is my body, broken for you. And whenever you eat this bread, do it in remembrance of me." And Jesus will leave them. And this is the last commandment to his disciples. And in the same way, he took the cup and said, "This is the new covenant, sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Every time you drink this cup, do it in remembrance of me." After he finished all his ministry, this is his commandment. So every time we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the saving grace of our Lord Jesus Christ until he comes. Just like Jesus, I want to do something different today. So I'm going to give bread to you and to maybe Tim. And then you can feed your neighbor with this bread, okay? So it's red with napkin, so it's not too dirty.
So as soon as you receive the bread and take it, we men the church normally take the bread together, but today is different. So everything is different today. So you feed your neighbor with the bread. So this is a sign of our love for each other.
I think Jesus gave this commandment to make sure that when one of the disciples had a hard time, then other disciples prayed for him and took care of him. So this is the meaning of community in our midst. And give it to Natalie, and then one to Tim again. So can you bring it? No.
Okay.
I changed my mind.
Okay.
Sorry.
That's fine.
So just. You can just pass it, and Tim. Just like you fed your neighbor with the bread, now you feed them with wine. It's juice, but it's wine.
you know, in the night, actually the communion took place. They didn't eat just a little piece. They ate until they were full. So I was tempted to buy many loaves of bread, but I found that a lot of stores closed today earlier. So I have only one bread. I apologize. So you don't have to wait, just drink as soon as you receive it. Now, if you are not too uncomfortable with the person next to you, let's hold hands together for as I pray for the communion, I mean. Are we still? Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we come before you again to thank you for the coming of Jesus Christ to us. He gives true life and peace that belong to the kingdom of heaven, not to the world. We take the bread and the wine to remember his birth, his ministry, and his death and resurrection, all of which proclaim that we are the people of God, to be called to manifest Jesus Christ through our lives. Please help us love all people, especially the people whose lives are ignored and despised. Help us live our life as his arms and feet in the world. O Lord, please make us one in the love of Jesus Christ. Please help us overcome the power and temptation of the world so that we may bear witness to the life, death, and the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. We're going to sing final two songs, and as our tradition, we're going to light the candles. So, Natalie, would you help me? Yeah. And Chris, would you help me? So, we're going to sing the first song, and then we're going to light the candles as two of them deliver to you. We're going to sing Silent Night and Holy Night together. Now let's sing Joy to the World loudly, loudly, loudly. Now, instead of me giving you benediction, we bless each other as our final blessing and benediction. So the person next to you, you can whisper or you can shout. Following me. The Lord bless you. And keep you. The Lord makes his face shine upon you. And be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Merry Christmas to you all. Thank you.
Thank you.